Go ahead. Well, good morning, everybody. We have another sunny Sunday. I love all this sunshine. I'm gonna miss it when it leaves, because it at least has kept me a little happier than I would have been. So we're just happy you're here, and we want to get started this morning with "Surely the Presence of the Lord is in this place."
Heavenly Father, we come before you this day. And Lord, we just, it's such a beautiful day. It just reminds us of the glory that surrounds you. And we know that you are Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And so, as we come into your house today, Lord, would you just allow your spirit to touch each one of our hearts. Father, be with those that aren't able to be here this day. Help them, Lord, to be able to worship you as well in their times at home. Those that are needing a little extra help, Lord, be there for them. Be their sustaining grace, be their hope for tomorrow, and just be their healer. for whatever the need may be. And so, Lord, thank you just that we're able to be here today. And thank you for each person that has made the trip to your house to spend time in your presence. We give you all the praise in the wonderful name of your Son, we ask it. Amen.
Let's sing, Jesus is all the world to me. Is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar, kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice, the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. the God of Jacob, is our fortress. Okay, listen, 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus.
First Sunday in October. Oh, yeah, it's getting that time already. In fact, Gene was kind of, the trees are all turning. They're starting to look like fall again. So we're just glad that you're here this morning, or that you're going to be watching this on the TV or on the computer or on your iPhone or whatever. We're just glad you're here. I got some news for you.
What?
Our new vinyl fence will arrive tomorrow.
Oh, really?
They called me on Friday and wanted to know if there was somebody here to deliver it. And I said, there is no one there to deliver it. And so it's sitting down in Hood River somewhere. And they're going to deliver it Monday morning. And so our project will start. So wish us luck. So let's see. Also, it's not too late for alabaster, so if you did do alabaster and you would like to, just mark it somehow and we will get it turned in. And this week, Pray for the Nation, Marlene wants to come and share a little bit with you. And so I'm going to invite her to come on up, because she has some prayer requests for you.
Well, good morning. I don't know how many of you have been aware, but Billy Graham on September 20th, not Billy Graham, but Franklin Graham, on September 26th, marched with a group of people and had prayer on the White House steps. And as he was praying, it was really good. The whole thing was really beautiful. And he had a lot of good speakers. Out of that came a request from the Lord to have his people pray for 30 days And out there in the foyer is this little packet that has prayers. They're not very big, and it's marked for each day a prayer. Now, you can read these prayers. They're not very long. You can say your own prayers, however, if you choose. But at least follow the guide here. It's really important. God has called us to pray and to help ask Him to heal our land. It's not a political thing. It is God's will that we want done in our land. And so it is really important that we pray, because the Lord was moved by the prayer for the land in 2 Samuel 24:25. So please, grab one of these. They're very short little prayers. The first day, nationwide transformation must begin in individual hearts. Pray for God to bring repentance, widespread renewal to the church, so that believers will boldly share His love with others and ask Him to draw lost people across our country to faith in Jesus Christ. So they're very short little prayers, and I know everybody can do it, you know. So please, out there in the foyer is this, and I really encourage you to get it and to pray for these next 30 days. So thank you.
Yeah, so go ahead and pick them up, because I know that there's people that within our church say, I don't know what to say. Well, now you do. And you can take those and make them personal, you know, and just pray, Lord, when it talked like it was in second hand, make it first hand. Just talk like it was you. Read the thing, make it a prayer of your heart, and let's pray for our country, because our country certainly needs it at this point. So let's see. And with that, I think we're going to take our morning offering. And so, John, if you'll come forward, we'll do that now. Let's pray for our offering. Heavenly Father, again, thank you so much for just allowing us to be in your presence. And Lord, you have blessed us. You have blessed us immeasurably. And so as we give back to you, please use it to fund your ministry here in Parkdale and help funding it around the world to bring new souls to the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And so we just give you all the praise and glory today as you accept this offering. Use it to glorify you. And we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh,
Savior leads me on. We have birthdays. If anybody has a birthday, anniversary, I forgot about that.
I know that somebody has an anniversary because I was talking, pointing at it. Yeah, if you have a birthday or an anniversary during the month of October, come on up.
Are you doing Mark's?
I'm doing Mark.
Okay, birthdays first. 48? Huh? Oh, shoot. This is my anniversary. It's 25, 50, 60. Yeah.
Just come close and we'll go. You can't do it.
I can't blow through that.
Here, I'll tell you what. Here we go.
There. Okay. Thank you.
Oh. Well, we have to figure out ways of making it all work.
Yeah.
Okay, now we can do some singing.
Yeah. Let's start all the way by Savior Leads Me.
Every peace divine.
again, good morning. This series is looking at some Old Testament people and seeing what they might have to say that might apply to us today. And so this morning we're talking about Joseph, and don't give up on your dream. You know, I bet there's not a person here who hasn't, if they don't have a dream in their life now, have had a dream in their life. I don't know what that dream might be, but whatever it is, I want you to keep it in mind as we study this morning. You know, because there was a dream that I had when I was about 21 years of age, and that was a dream of maybe someday becoming a pastor. And I bring that up primarily only because it only took a 30-year detour to get there. But it was a detour that I think that the Lord knew. But you know, the thing is the Lord knew, you know, even when I didn't, what was going to happen. The Lord is full knowledgeable about everything. And so he knew what was going to happen, when it was going to happen, and everything. And so today we're going to look at the life of Joseph, who a man who literally dreamed for God and attained those dreams in his lifetime. And basically, Joseph's life covers 13 chapters of Genesis. So he takes up quite a room in our Bible. And I'm going to attempt to kind of summarize enough for you. I know most of you probably have heard the story of Joseph, but it's been a while since you actually read it or whatever. But when Joseph was 17 years of age, he had two dreams that showed that he would be a great man and that his brothers and his father would bow down to him. Now, you can imagine when he told his brothers of that dream, those dreams, how they were going to respond to that. And they become very, very jealous of Joseph. And one day decided out in the field that they were going to kill him. But rather than kill him, they sold Joseph into slavery to some merchants who then sold him to the Pharaoh's officials in Egypt, a man called Potiphar. And Joseph's brothers then lied to their father, leading him to believe that some wild animals had eaten Joseph up. Joseph, while he was in with the slavery, found favor with Potiphar. The Egyptian had purchased him, and that led Potiphar to give him kind of full reign in Potiphar's house. So Potiphar put him in charge of his entire household, and God's blessing came upon that household. Only problem was, his Potiphar's wife was kind of attracted to Joseph, because the Bible says he was a good-looking guy. And she tried to seduce him, and that didn't work, and Joseph refused, and then was accused of attempted rape, because he wouldn't give in to what her wishes were. And so that got him thrown into prison. And while he was in prison, a couple people got thrown into prison from the Pharaoh, and they had a couple dreams, and he interpreted their dreams. And even though they interpreted dreams, it took 2 years for that to come about to be a blessing to Joseph. And God interpreted the dream for Pharaoh, using Joseph as a vessel to show that dream. Now, Joseph told Pharaoh that Egypt was going to have 7 years of prosperous life and then 7 years of great famine. And Joseph then gave Pharaoh a plan that he could actually save Egypt. And Pharaoh and his men thought it was so good that they appointed Joseph as a powerful leader in Egypt, second only to the Pharaoh himself. And in time, Joseph's family back home got struck by that same famine, as you remember, and because Egypt had all of the grain and stuff, they had to go, and so we'll be talking about that. And you know, ultimately, they had to bow down before Joseph, just as he dreamed of many years before. And so sometimes those dreams that we have don't come to fruition for quite some time. That doesn't mean we should give up on our dreams. But I want you to realize that the main reason for Joseph's dream was not so to get people to bow down to him, but it was to show that God can use even one man or one woman that's fully devoted to him to accomplish some great things. And so we're going to look a little more in depth at Joseph's story and see why we should never give up on our dreams. Well, don't give up on your dreams even when, number one, people are opposed to it. Did Joseph face opposition? You bet he did. We're just going to give you a couple of scriptures from chapter 37 in verse 10. When he told his father as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him, told him about the dream, and said, "What is this dream you had? Will your mother and I, your brothers, actually come and bow down to the ground before you?" I'm sure that the family did not appreciate the dream that Joseph had. And then in verses 18 through 20, it says, "But they saw him at a distance, and before he reached them, they plotted to kill him." This is his brothers. "Here comes that dreamer," they said to each other. "Come now, let's kill him. Throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams." Well, you know, most people that will oppose your dreams don't have any dreams of their own. You know, and so they don't see anything really in the future, and so they're going to be the ones who are going to be naysayers for your dreams. Because you might receive a vision from God for the future, and you might have the faith even to step out and do whatever God has called you to do. But I want you to realize that the negative people around you will try to stop you. They will try to discourage you. They will say negative things about you. But if it's a dream or a vision from God, you must move on no matter who tries to stop you. One of the district superintendents told me one time we were talking about people that had a call on their life and then didn't answer that call from God. And he told me, he said, "Carl, my experience has been over the years is that if somebody actually has a call from God put on their life and they don't answer that call, some way, shape, or form, God never lets them really off the hook. And consequently, they lead other than a completely happy life because they're not doing what God wants them to do. And so it's always best to be able to follow through. And when I cast a vision and someone's negative at it, first of all, I try to evaluate what their motives are. You know, why would they be being negative? I mean, sometimes we just don't like change. And that's understandable because I think the vast majority of us, particularly in this church, when vast majority of us are older, change comes about hard. But if you believe that you have a dream that's God's dream, in a nice way, as nice as possible, tell them that you're going where God wants you to go, whether they like it or not. And they can either get on board with you, or they cannot get on board. But number two, don't give up your dream even when you experience serious setbacks. Now, every one of us has ever accomplished anything for God has been knocked down plenty of times. That's just the way God works. In fact, if you never experience what would can be considered a failure, you're probably not trying very hard. Because failure, it just comes to help boost us up and give us strength to go on. Well, let's look at the setbacks of Joseph's experience. I mean, first of all, he told them the story of how they were going to bow down to him. I don't think he fully understood at that point what the dream was all about, but he told them, and his family rebuked him for the dream. Then what happened is his brothers, instead of killing him, sold him into slavery. Now, that in itself might be enough to just cancel your dream completely, but not the case with Joseph. Because he got sold into slavery, he got a new master, Potiphar, and Joseph acted in a responsible, God-given manner. And when he did that, Potiphar realized that there was something different about this man. And so he found favor in Potiphar's as his owner. But in the same time, what happened again, he was accused of attempted rape by a Potiphar's wife. I mean, you'd think that would be enough to just fry your dreams. And then what happened? He got thrown into prison for no reason. Because he was trying to do what God wanted to do. He was trying to be a responsible person. He was trying not to allow the wife to seduce him. And he gets thrown into prison. But even while he's there, things kind of turn around. And all of a sudden, there was a couple of the Pharaoh's men that came in, got thrown into prison, and they each had a dream, and they didn't know what that dream meant, and lo and behold, they came to Joseph to interpret their dreams. And their dreams came true, just as Joseph said. And Joseph said, "Now, if your dream comes true, remember me." Well, the one who had a good dream did remember him, but it took 2 years. 2 years for him to even remember. And then Joseph appears before Pharaoh, and soon his dream was fulfilled. You see, Joseph's entire life was a series of setbacks and then accomplishment. And so, what about you? What about you? Are you letting some setbacks keep you from fulfilling your dream? And probably I'm thinking more to the younger people, but even us in our older age, God may be putting some kind of dream on our heart of something that we might do or could do for Him. And it's really easy for us to say, "Well, my back hurts, my leg hurts, I'm too old, I can't get around. God, I can't do that. You can find somebody else." But if God really wants us to do it, we ought to go forward with it. You need to recognize that setbacks are what they are. Setbacks are nothing more than steps necessary to push forward, to learn from others who and how can to model what our dreams really are. And maybe your dream requires a college education like mine did. I mean, I went and got a college degree in law enforcement, but not in ministry. And at close to 51 years of age, when I had the opportunity to become a pastor, I went, "Oh, goody." And I'll be honest with you, I have stigmatism. And when I read a book, the lines kind of go, the letters in those, and it's hard for me to read. And I remember sitting in my office going, "Lord, if you want me to do this, you're going to have to make it so I can read." And I bet I read 150 books all the way through. I mean, I remember when I was in high school and I thought that was bad. You know, I had to read chapter here and chapter there, and I had to do whatever I had to do to do it. And not when I went to college, I had to read the whole book. And I've got the, and, but you know, the Lord helped me get through it. And the first thing that, that happened is a class in the Pentateuch, and it, which is one of the harder classes they got. And I got this A+. And I thought, gosh, I wonder if I could do that again. And I did it again and again. And like my daughter, I remember, and I've probably told you this, I know I have told you this before, but when she went to high school, one daughter got complete straight A's, and Kat got 1 B. And all of high school got 1 B. And I think that bummed her out a little bit, that she did only got that 1 B.
For talking too much.
Not
my school.
And so when I went to college, I got 1 B. And so I told her, I said, well, we just keep it in the family. Because I wasn't real happy about my 1 B either, but you know, that's the way it is. But you know, the thing is if it's a God thing, He'll make sure that it gets worked out. One way or the other. And there will be setbacks. I can guarantee you, it took me 7 years to get that degree. And the first time when we first did it, we were doing it online. I was using a dial-up connection in the church parsonage with an old computer. And half the time it would knock you offline. You had to send all of your lessons in, do it on the computer, and then by midnight have to send it in. And there were many times, I remember one time we were on vacation in Las Vegas. I had to have my report in by midnight. Everybody else was doing all these things, and I had to sit at the computer doing this report. You couldn't save it, you just had to send it in. And I sent it in, and the internet crashed. And I lost everything that I had completely done. My other daughter heard me screaming and yelling and crying, and it was like I spent the next 4 hours redoing everything that I had done. But the Lord got me through, and thanks to that. Perhaps you have a call in your life to be a minister or a missionary or doing something for God. Move out in faith, and God will help you to take the lead. And so don't let setbacks, don't even look at them in a negative way. Recognize them as the stepping stones to accomplishment. And you will see your dreams fulfilled. And like I said, if it's a God's dream and you're ready to do it, He will help you fill it. Number three, it may take a long time to realize your dream. I mean, let's face it, with Joseph, it took over 20 years for him to see his dream fulfilled. And although his setbacks were a whole lot worse than mine, if it's a God dream, God will help us through. Dreams are conceived long before they're achieved. Keep that in mind. And the period between the birth of a dream and the realization is what we call the process of following God. And as there was with Joseph, as there was in my life, and I think probably most everybody's life, if it's a really God dream, it's usually a big dream. And not just a little dream. God doesn't do things little, He does them big. And there's going to be periods filled with doubts. There's going to be periods filled with adversity, surprises, maybe even some changes along the way. And there's going to be good days and there's going to be bad days. And often during the time we're facing with a dilemma, do I continue on or do I give up now? And as we run life's race, Joseph shows us that the journey is always worth the cost. If it's a God journey, if it's a God dream, it's worth the cost if the Lord is really in it. And so let's look at Joseph's kind of words of encouragement. I mean, if we could talk with Joseph right now, I think he'd have at least three words of encouragement for us as we journey towards him. First of all, I want you to realize that, number one, God will always be with you. God will always be with you. Joseph, I think, understood God's presence in his life. No matter what he was going through, God was there with him. When Joseph was sold to Potiphar, the Bible tells us in Genesis 39:11-2, it says, "The Lord was with Joseph, and he prospered, and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master." And then after Joseph was accused of attempting rape and was sent to prison, in verse 23, it says, "The warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care, because the Lord was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did." You see, if you study the placement of this statement, "the Lord was with Joseph," it might even actually leave you a little confused. When you really read all the way through Joseph's story, you can see that when he was in trouble, the Lord was with him. The Bible says when he went from son to slave, the Lord was with Joseph. We might have expected that statement to apply to the good times in Joseph's life. But the Bible states the truth even when the truth appears to be illogical. You see, what's amazing is that after this point, you know, after Joseph begins to prosper and life is going well, we don't see that statement anymore. It should strike us that Moses, the author of Genesis, doesn't at this point accentuate the reality that God's presence in his life. I mean, look at this. From son to slave, the Lord was with him. From slave to prisoner, the Lord was with him. And yet, from prisoner to prime minister, we don't see anything about the Lord being with Joseph. Could it be that during the good times, God's presence appears self-evident? But maybe it is, we really need that reminder during the hard times. It's when life isn't going really well that we need to be lifted up. But I want you to know that God is with us no matter what, in every situation. We probably really don't need to be reminded. And that's, I think, why Genesis doesn't really show God's presence with Joseph in the good times, because God's always there. He's always with him. Is it possible that God's more active in our lives when we're hurting and need his presence? I think those are times when we really need that reminder. I think we need to have those times when God is really there. You know, that's a little bit like the footprints in the sand, and the times when there's only one set of footprints, because that's when God's carrying us along. We need to have that. But God is always with us, no matter what. Could it be that God's hierarchy, the good times are only for good times, but the bad times really can be the best times? I mean, in all honesty, as a kid, the best lessons that I learned usually was the hard lessons. I mean, when I learned the hard lesson, it was really one that really stuck with me. So when is the Lord with us? I think you can all answer that. He's always with us. When do you need to know that? Always need to know that. But like Joseph, we need to feel God's presence most when circumstances hide him from our view. When there's times in your life that you question, God, are you really there? Those are the times when you really need to have him there. You need to feel his presence. When it seems as though someone sold you into slavery or thrown you into prison or really knocked you down, remember that the Lord was with Joseph and why the Lord was with him. The Lord was there to help him get through. Now, the second thing was that God will develop you during those down times. And that is that God will develop you in those down times if you let him. Remember, there's things that we have to do to let God work, because we can just turn our back and say no. You know that in 13 chapters that recorded Joseph's story, with all the garbage that had been put up with, I can't find one single time, not one time in all of that, where Joseph complained about his circumstances. When Joseph was sold into slavery, he took the time to develop himself to be the best household servant Potiphar had, and the Lord blessed him. He didn't whine about it because he was a slave. He set his sights on being the best slave that he could be. When Joseph was thrown into prison, he didn't whine about that either. He used that time to develop himself and was put in charge of all the other prisoners. And when Joseph was brought before the Pharaoh, God interpreted Pharaoh's dream. And Joseph used the skills that he had learned and had developed during all of those down times to be able to explain to Pharaoh what that dream really meant and come up with a plan that would save Egypt and save the Pharaoh. And I know that this is one of the hardest lessons for us to learn, but it's a lesson I think that we need to learn. God will use some of the worst experiences in our lives to develop us, so that when it's time for our dream to be fulfilled, we'll be ready to take charge. You know, we say the same thing about church. How's God going to bring people to our church if we're not ready to accept them? How's God going to bring children into our church if there's nobody that dare to do children's church or Sunday school? I'm sure God wants to bring people into our church, but we need to be ready. We need to be working. We need to develop ourselves individually and corporately to be able to take on more responsibility. Well, number three is that God will finish what he started. I think there's a song or something like that. You know, if your dream is a God-given dream, if it really is a God-driven dream, God will complete it in your lifetime. Many years after Joseph's brother had sold him into slavery, they came to him to beg for forgiveness. But Joseph had to say to them in Genesis 50:20, he said, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." You know, Joseph could look back on his entire life and see the whole time that God was with him, and that God was leading him to the fulfillment of his dream. And even those things that were meant to hold him back, those many stumbling stones, God used those to form in him the character that was necessary to be there to fulfill God's purpose and in the dream that Joseph had, and to save not only all of Egypt, but to save his family as well. You see, God never leaves business unfinished. And if your dream is part of God's business, he will accomplish it. He will accomplish it. And so as we conclude, I want to share a little story with you. It was a fog-shrouded morning in July 4th, 1952, when a young woman named Florence Chadwick waded into the water off Catalina Island in California. And she intended to swim the channel to the island, from the island to the California coast. The long-distance swimming wasn't new to her, and she had been the first woman to swim the English Channel in both directions. The water was numbingly cold that day. The fog was so thick that she could hardly see the boats in her party. And several times sharks had to be driven away by rifle fire. She swam and swam more than 15 hours before she was asked to be taken out of the water. Her trainer tried to encourage her to swim on since they were close to land, but when Florence looked, all she could see was fog. So she quit, only a half mile from her goal. Later she said, "I'm not excusing myself, but if I could have seen land, I might have made it." You see, it wasn't the cold. It wasn't fear. It wasn't even exhaustion that caused Florence Chadwick to fail that day. What was it that caused her to fail? It was fog. The reason that the fog made her fail is because she couldn't see the land ahead. She couldn't see the end of the race. And so, I want you to know that 2 weeks later, she tried the same thing and set a record time, never been beat to this day, as far as I know, in setting and swimming that channel, because it wasn't foggy and she could see the end of her race. I hope that you can see that the foundation for realizing your dream is found in God and God alone. He's the one who sets up the dream that I'm talking about. And I want you to realize also that God is always with you. Yet we need to feel God's presence most when the circumstance is hiding from our view. When you don't feel like he's there, that's when we really need to have his help. And if you let him, like Joseph did, God will take you on a journey of a lifetime. You know, at 51, I could retire, and then I became a pastor, and I figured I'd probably do this for 5 years or maybe 10 years or something until I was really ready to retire. And now it's been over 20 years. And I'm sorry, at this point, I don't feel called to quit. We need to grow our church. We need to grow God's ministry. And if God's in control, it'll happen. Would you stand with me and we'll close with a word of prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you today. And Father, as we look at the characters in the Bible, and these characters in the Old Testament, and we see how they kept their faith, and you kept them, their dreams, like Joseph, to come to fruition, even though it took 20 years. Father, I feel like we're easier off than Joseph, because you say we have the Holy Spirit as Christians residing in us. And so the Holy Spirit ought to be there to help nudging us along, to help us to see that the dream that you have for us to fulfill. And so, Lord, whether it's a dream for this church, in a little way, Lord, it might even be a dream for that fence that's going to be built out around the church. We're going to do it ourselves. But, Lord, we need your help to get it done so that it looks like something that will glorify you and be something we're proud of at the church. And so, Lord, we need your help always. And we know that you're always with us. Even when it doesn't seem like it, you're there. And all we have to do is reach out and take your hand, and you'll carry us along. And so this day, Father, bless each person here. Bless each person who hears your message and speak to their hearts as only you can do, and deliver the message that you want delivered. Because what message might come to me might not be the same message that you give to someone else. But Father, if it comes from you, it's a good message. And so, Lord, bless each person here this day. Bless them, guide them, help them to see their dreams come to reality, the dream that you put on their heart. And we thank you, we praise you, and we ask you for that same thing for this church, that you would grow your church, that you would grow it numerically, that you would grow it spiritually, and Lord, that you would help us to be all that you want us to be. And we give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' wonderful, precious name. And everyone said, amen. Thank you. Praise the Lord. We'll see you next week. Honey.